Good morning, Sabah al-Khair. Here. My name is Agata Mościcka, and this is my great pleasure to attend this session as a moderator and introduce our first speaker, our respected colleague, who knows the power of education, who is the chairman of this conference and pediatric cardiologist, serving currently and sharing his knowledge in UAE. So Dr. Mohammed received his pediatric certification from Columbia University in 2002, followed by his pediatric cardiology exams 6 years later. And we are happy to have him here in UAE. He will present the topic regarding fetal cardiology and its impact of perinatal management and outcome. Welcome.
Thank you for everyone. Thank you, Dr. Agata, for the nice introduction. And how many pediatricians here? Raise your hand. How many nurses? How many fathers and mothers? All. Okay. If you are a father or a mother, or plan to be a father or mother, then this is your place for the lecture. So I'm going to talk today about an issue. Usually we don't discuss it in general pediatric talk, but I think it's very important and it's a forgotten subject for us to know. Many of the pediatricians, they only get the trouble after the baby is born, and they don't know what happened before that and what's going on and how the patient was taken care of. They only know that the patient have a hypoblast or have a transposition of great artery, but they don't know the story before this time. So we're gonna talk today, I have no conflict of interest, and then we're gonna talk about fetal cardiology and prenatal program. We're gonna talk also about the impact on postnatal outcome, and we're gonna have a game in the end, so prepare yourself. Many of you may know my style. Usually I will ask questions and I will point to you if you are working in your phone. So please silence your phone, hide it in your pocket, otherwise you're gonna be trapped with a question. All right, so the first thing here, we're gonna go to fetal circulation. As you see here, there is the umbilical vein. Umbilical vein is just like pulmonary veins, it's the most oxygenated one, and draw blood all the way to the right atrium, and from the right atrium go straight to the left atrium, and then left ventricle and go to the brain. So one of the connection inside the heart, you have the BFO, which basically allow the blood from the right to the left side. And then you have the blood coming back to the heart from the SVC and the IVC, going to the right ventricle. And then from the right ventricle to the pulmonary artery. Since we don't have lung that functioning at that time, so the blood goes straight forward through the BDA. And again, if you are working in pediatric, BDAs should be a very well-known name for you and a very, very important connection in prenatal cardiology. And then after that, go to the DEO or the descending aorta. So prenatal ultrasound, the first time that we start prenatal ultrasound is about 1970, and it was best just as an academic. So it's a really somehow a new field, but anything has to do with any technology between 1 year and the other, and then the year after that, it really moved very, very fast. So now in 2018, with ultrasound, we can diagnose congenital heart disease, we can look at the physiology of the heart, we can diagnose even arrhythmia and treat arrhythmia before birth, and we can really look at how the congenital heart disease developed over the days and the weeks and months. So this was one of the first ultrasound. If you look at it, you will say, what is this? It's just not something that I can understand. However, right now we have like a 4D where we can see the baby smiling in front of you. I don't know if you think he's smiling or not, but he's smiling supposedly. And we can look inside the heart, and we can look at the arrhythmia of the heart, the chambers of the heart, and so on. So from the genetic point of view, this is in 1966 when we look at the karyotype, and we are able to identify the 23 karyotypes. But now, fish introduced in 1990. In 2018, we can even look at the whole chromosome and the whole genome of the human being. So we have advanced very, very, very much in the genetic field. So why do we need to screen for congenital heart disease? First of all, congenital heart disease is the most common lethal problem that the baby will face in the first day of or in the first year of life. So knowing that the baby may have a congenital heart disease and what's going to happen after that is very important for us as a pediatrician. So it's the most common congenital defect, and the majority of this congenital heart disease come in not known risk mothers. So, you know, mother is very happy, she has a baby, she's pregnant, there is no problem, everything going smoothly, and finally the baby is born, and then they face a huge, huge congenital heart problem with a lot of potential for surgeries and so on. So it's a major impact. This is not a real number from studies, but I just calculated from what we have, how much birth we have in Dubai, how much birth we have in Abu Dhabi, and I assume how many births we have from calculation from Northern Emirate. So about 100 children born every year. So about 100 of them, this is okay. So about 1,000 children with congenital heart disease, and at least there is 100,000. This is the first number. About 100 to 200 with critical congenital heart disease. So how do we do ultrasound before birth? There is three levels that for the ultrasound. Level one, which we call look at basically the baby size, cardiac motion, and usually this is if you are a mom and you go to the OBGYN doctors, they will send you to the technician there and she will look at basic stuff. So when they tell you, when you get this kind of ultrasound, you basically tell you that you have a baby and we don't know what's going on with him, you are pregnant, thank you, congratulations. So there is not much information you can gain from this to assure you that your baby is doing good. Then you go to the level two, which are more detailed. So they look at the fetal structure survey and fourth chamber of the heart. And this is done usually by radiologist and prenatologist. So this is the second stage of looking at the baby inside the mom. Level three, this is what we call it complete and detailed, where we look at a specific organ, either from the heart or from the brain and so on. So when we are talking about fetal echocardiography, usually it's done by pediatric cardiologist or done by a prenatologist. Many of the radiologists, they do it. As far my experience, it has gone in understanding what's going on in the country. Few people really, really competent in doing a proper fetal cardiology evaluation outside the prenatologist and pediatric cardiologist. So what do we need to know about looking at the heart? The most important, as you see here, this is what we call it the fourth chamber, similar to what we see after birth. So this is the back of the baby, this is the front of the baby, and here you have the left side of the heart, left ventricle, left atrium, right ventricle, right atrium. So simply you can look at the fourth chamber and you can decide if there is any defect. If you are capable of looking appropriately at the fourth chamber, you probably will diagnose about 50% of the whole total congenital heart disease. So this is a very important picture. Most of the OB radiologists and so on, they will be able to identify this kind of fourth chamber. However, when you want to look at the outflow, which is the picture here, this is looking at the outflow, and this is the pulmonary, and this is the aorta here, and this is with color, and this also with color. This is a little more difficult, more challenging. However, the thing that you get from there is the most important congenital heart disease. So knowing the outflow will allow you to know about a transposition, tetralogy, truncus, interrupted arch, and so on. So knowing at the outflow tract is a very important in evaluating fetal echo. I have seen many reports from radiologists or from OB and so on saying heart is normal. For me, this word doesn't really anything. It means that you didn't look and you didn't know. So saying a heart is normal doesn't, and then when we see a heart has a hypoblast after, how do you say heart is normal? If what we always ask people to do, if you cannot say this is normal, then don't say it. Just say, I don't see it or I cannot evaluate it. Okay, so who should go for fetal echo? Maternal risk, family risk, or fetal risk? So either the mom or the fetus or something in the family. So that's simple things to say. So who's the mom should go? Either mom with diabetes, especially type 1, or some immune disease, or history, mom with history. So as a pediatrician, when the mom come to you, ask for family history. Do you have any congenital heart disease? Anybody else has congenital heart disease? And if that's true, then advise her when she get pregnant next time to go and see a proper evaluation by a pediatric cardiologist or by a perinatologist to look at the heart of the baby specifically. So, and there is some other things here, teratogen and so on, or abnormal serum screen. Family history, any family history of congenital heart disease, there is an increased risk. As we all know, congenital heart disease is about 1% of the whole population. However, if the mom has a previous congenital heart disease, or the father or the brother, that percentage increase, especially in the left side of the heart. So you have more likely to have a congenital heart disease. Maybe sometimes 5%, 10%, 15%, and sometimes even 20%. So this number increase if there is a family history. So please make evaluating of congenital heart disease or family history of congenital heart disease part of your history when you are taking a history for your patient. And then if you have any specific syndrome, and we know every syndrome is associated with something else, so especially Williams syndrome, DeGeorge, Noonan, Marfan, Down syndrome, and so on. And then in this country specifically, I'm going to talk about it later, but consanguinity is a very major risk for congenital heart disease or for any other chromosomal anomalies or for any other diseases. From the fetal point of view, if you have any non-cardiac anomaly, so the baby has brain problem, has kidney problem, has gut problem, this is an indication for you also. Please look at the fetal heart very carefully and give me a good information so I can plan for my child better. Or if you are suspecting congenital heart defect, chromosomes problem, increased nuchal translucency, and hydrops and arrhythmia. So all of this is an indication for fetal echo. IVF, I found it is one of the most important, and people don't know when you go to the IVF, you just increase your risk of congenital heart disease tremendously from 1% to about 4 or 5% or so. So these parents who work so hard to get the baby, surprisingly, and I have seen many of them, surprisingly, they usually get a terrible congenital heart disease like pulmonary atresia, hypoblast, and so on. So these people, they get more increased risk for congenital heart disease. So the IVF, I don't know if many of you, the octopus mom, this is when they were born here, and this is right now after how many years, probably 10 years or so. So this is all at one time. Hopefully, you know, they didn't have any congenital heart disease. Probably I will not be able to do a fetal echo for all of them. So this is a true challenges. So IVF is a very important if you know that the mother, please make it sure that she has a proper evaluation for the fetal heart. And again, remember, many of the OB, many of the radiologists don't provide enough or appropriate evaluation of congenital heart disease. I personally has been involved in a few cases where the OB doctor has been sued by the family or, you know, and then we look at what we are doing, and we find there is a huge gap in our training and in our understanding of fetal heart. So other problem, you know, including IV, include hydrops, twin-to-twin, and intrauterine growth retardation, and consanguinity is not part of what you're gonna see in the book. But for this country, in my opinion, it's a very, very important, and I'm gonna show you why. My colleague, Dr. Hamdan, who's sitting here in the front desk, he did a study, and I will talk about it. So why do we need prenatal diagnosis? What's the problem? I can't just wait until after birth. The problem after birth, you cannot screen everyone for congenital heart disease. So screening every single person is not a possibility. And there is some new improvement. We'll talk about it later. But so you need, if you know what's the diagnosis, you need to reassure the parents, look up for other anomalies, look for therapeutic intervention if there is any arrhythmia and so on. And importantly, most important, improve the outcome. So this is all very important for us when we diagnose prenatally. So why do we need prenatal diagnosis? This is the study I talked about, Dr. Hamdan. He did with a group of perinatologists at Tawam Hospital about 6 or 7 years ago. So they look at the total number, about 3,000 fetuses, and they look at the congenital heart disease, about 150. As you see, the percentage is 7.1, which is a very high. Usually we expect to get 1%, but this 7.1 is one of the reasons, because this is a tertiary center, and the referral was usually a higher risk than the average people. So, and then the consanguinity was about 65%, which is a very, very high number for us. So we believe this is probably a major factor for congenital heart disease as well. The detection of the complex congenital heart disease, I'm talking about complex, was about 90%, which is a very, very good number. If you look across the board, how much we are able to detect congenital heart disease probably vary from 5% to 95%. It depends, and you can tell how big is the difference between 5% and 95%. It's so huge. Why? Because there is so many factors that involved in the evaluation. So the detection before that, you can assume probably at best in UAE, of what we know, is probably about 15 to 20% or so. An extra cardiac problem for this patient who has a cardiac problem was almost about 50%. So when you have a heart problem, look for outside the heart. When you have outside the heart, look for the heart. So there is a big, big link. When you have something abnormal, it's going to go everywhere. Your heart is going to be affected. Your brain may be affected. Your kidney may be affected, and so on. So looking at what kind of congenital heart disease they find, and this is the only study really we have with fetal echo in this country. So left ventricle obstruction about 25 plus. Conotruncal malformation, 21%, septal defect, about 18%. Surprisingly, cardiomyopathy, which is a major congenital inherited problem with link to genetic, was about 16%. So that's to tell you there is a lot of marriages between the families, and that increase the number of the patient who has problems in the heart. So how can we establish prenatal cardiac program where we can work on the families and the child and the moms and the doctors and so on? This is an example. This program we have it initially in Tawam Hospital. Currently we're carrying it on with Dr. Hamdan and the team at Oasis Hospital. In that hospital, we have a perinatologist, we have, of course, a OB, we have obstetrician, neonatologist, ultrasonographer. Currently, we don't have the genetic counselor, but very soon in the way. The cardiothoracic surgery, currently, we depend on SKMC to provide, and some of the patients go to Al Jalila and some go to abroad. So what do we do in this kind of program? We educate the patient. We have a good planning for them. We tell them what to expect, what not to expect. No surprise after birth, so the family has a time to adjust to the fact that this is a hypoblast, and I expect that I might need to take vacation or off from my work for 3 months or for 6 months. So you're planning very much appropriately according to your need and the time to adjust to your outcome. 5 minutes? No way. Is that true? Are you sure? Okay. So to build the program, you need all of these kind of things. So we are planning to teach people how to do fetal cardiology. And this is just an example. This is a true patients with coarctation of the aorta. The one of them, nobody know about them, and the other one, we know. So the first one ended up by being in the hospital for about 2 weeks, and basically we are successfully repaired the coarctation, and the patient did well, but the mortality and morbidity was higher in a patient who we don't know about. And the other one, so the other one is the proper scenarios, which you have a patient who has, you know, family history of congenital heart disease, then you send for proper fetal echo, you find that there is a coarctation, and then you plan the delivery in the specific center, in specific place, everybody is ready, everybody knows about what's going on, they start prostaglandin on time, and so on. So this baby outcome and morbidity is far, far better than the usual patient. I'm just going to keep going. So when you see our report, when we write a report for fetal echo, and this is what you should see as a pediatrician, or if you are working in NICU, And you receive a report from me or from Dr. Hamdan or from Dr. Anas, that's what you're usually going to see. So the mode of the delivery, usually normal spontaneous vaginal delivery, no problem. Congenital heart disease does not increase the risk usually for cesarean section. So don't be pushed for that. And the admission will tell you, the admission to NICU or to the regular floor will tell you if there is any oxygen need, will tell you if there is any prostaglandin need, will tell you about the time, when should you call me the next day or call me immediately. I will give you that information. So you really have a very good insight inside what we will tell you also what, when to expect the surgery, if the patient can go home and so on. So the neonatologist or the person who's working in NICU will have a peace of mind that he knows if and how to call me if he need to call me for the baby. There is, this is a very important that adding to the fetal diagnosis, what we say about oxygen saturation, and we have three areas here. Patient who has less than 90%, usually we provide this after 24 hours after birth. So if you didn't diagnose prenatally, hopefully you'll catch the patient after, and the oxygen saturation should pick up at least 5 out of 6, if you are doing it appropriately, of congenital heart disease who are critical. So, but you still can miss a congenital heart disease if you are doing the saturation after 24 hours. Anybody less than 90, immediate referral to congenital, to cardiologist. Anybody above 95, you are fine. Anybody in between, this is the, you know, when you wait for 1 hour, you repeat, you wait for another hour, you repeat. If the patient go either way, toward the 90 or toward the 95, then you act accordingly. So I will give you one game. This is what we see in congenital heart disease. Hopefully I will have enough to do with a normal patient. So usually they are not cyanotic, they have no symptoms, they have saturation 99%. NICU patient is not, admission is not needed, oxygen is not needed, intubation is not needed, gas not needed. Basically you are talking about normal child. Okay, the only difference when he's born, he still have a BDA, which provide, BDA is here, which provide the blood from the aorta to the pulmonary and supposed to close in the next 1 or 2 days or so. So this is a normal scenario. So I'm gonna talk about hypoblastic left heart. So is the, I'm gonna ask the audience, do you think hypoblast is a cyanotic patient? Okay, when can you decide this patient is cyanotic? How can you tell, you as a pediatrician? Anyone? Huh? From his color, good. This is Osama, and he's not a pediatrician. He know you can look at the color. This is the problem. If you look at a dark-skinned person, we are all cyanotic. We are natural. So looking at the color of the person is not easy to decide. You have really to have a saturation less than 85%. So keep that in mind. Looking at any child, and look yourself to NICU, or to any child come to you. If you just look at their face, you're not going to know that this is a cyanotic child. Okay, so what you need to look inside the mouth, if you really want to look, if this patient is cyanotic, that even when you look inside the mouth, you're not gonna see unless the saturation go below 90, or below 85, and below 80, and then you can recognize it more and more. So it's not an easy challenge. So do you need to admit this patient to NICU, hypoblast? Okay, so you need to admit them to NICU, okay. So this is the, wait a minute, I'm going backward. Okay, so this, let me just introduce you to the hypoblast, and this is a really a good example of critical congenital heart disease that will need surgery. And if I finish this scenario, I can stop, all right? So the hypoblast is basically the left side ventricle, as you see here, is very, very small. You can say it's not there. The aorta, very, very small, or even not there. So basically, you are depending on the right ventricle. So the right ventricle serving both the systemic and the pulmonary circulation. So the blood go through the pulmonary artery here, and some of it go to the pulmonary valve, the pulmonary arteries branches, and some of it go to the BDA and go to the rest of the body. So at birth, do you think you're gonna notice any symptoms for congenital heart disease with hypoblast? Anyone? No, nothing. Normal, beautiful baby, everybody happy. Do you think you're gonna send him home the next day? Most likely you will. Okay, there is a problem with their saturation, especially the hypoblast, and I'm gonna talk why. So initially, the patient has no symptoms. Then there is a drop in the pulmonary resistance, and the blood, since there is only one source for the blood, which is the pulmonary artery, will have a choice. Go to either to the pulmonary arteries or go to the body. So which way is easy, you think? Go to the lung or go to the body?
The
the lung, low resistant, about 10th, one of 10th. So the baby will have, in about 24 hours will start, will increase, because the lung will be more wet, will have more pulmonary edema and so on. So he will saturation because there is a lot of blood going to the lung, maybe in the 90, 95, and so on. Actually, one time in Tawam Hospital, we have a prenatal diagnosis of patient with hypoplast, and they were triplet. And then after birth, I took Dr. Hamdan and the rest of the team, and we challenged ourselves. Can we diagnose this patient? We know one of the three has hypoplast. We know for sure. But which one is it? We talk to the neonatologist. Can you look with us? And everybody looked. And you know what? We picked the wrong guy. And the guy was the intrauterine growth retardation. We thought this looked the most sick guy. He must be the hypoplast. And we were wrong, because when we bought the echo, then we know it wasn't. It's actually the one with the higher weight, the good one, the one that I will send first to home. So be always careful and always think what you're going to decide. So usually the saturation, only when they are cyanotic, you're going to see it if it's less than 85. And symptoms, initially no symptoms, then later you will have symptoms. Saturation could be between 70% up to 99%. And it could be even dead. It depends when he presents to you. So NICU, usually if you know about the diagnosis, admit to NICU. Oxygen, please no oxygen. Any patient with one source of blood, either right or left, this patient, usually they don't need oxygen, because you're going to lower the pulmonary resistance even further, and you're going to make the pulmonary edema even further. Finish? 1 minute. I am, you know, the organizing scientific, so I can get 1 minute. I changed the rule. So this patient, you should give them prostaglandin, because they depend on the prostaglandin, and they will need surgery before they go home. Definitely this patient, they need UAC and UVC, because that will make your life much easier later. You might not find an IV line for them, and you need to give them prostaglandin. You're going to be stuck if you don't have a good central line. And feeding, always congenital heart disease, the majority, don't worry, feed them. They're going to be okay. Okay, so, and ultrasound, always do ultrasound for patient with critical congenital heart disease. And that ultrasound always for the brain and for the kidney mainly. So this is a two problem. If you don't, then the patient will go and they will find he has no brain. He is an anencephaly, and then you already did the surgery for him, and that's not going to be a good time for you to learn that he has no brain. So learn about it far before you send this patient to the surgery. And finally, every single patient with congenital heart disease critical, they deserve to have a specific genetic evaluation for their problem. I'm gonna move forward. Just I want to show you one more thing. Transposition, remember this, transposition, always the upper extremities on the 80s, the lower extremities 100. So that's transposition until proven otherwise. And finally, take home message, fetal echo is essential in detecting congenital heart disease. Fetal echo improve outcome, less surprise after birth, and keep in mind, your next patient may be congenital heart disease. And this is what we're gonna end in the end of the day. If you diagnose properly before birth, this is what you're gonna get, more adult with congenital heart disease. And please save the date for our next conference. It's gonna be in Dubai in the beginning of April. Thank you very much.